into what's could be happening. A lot is expected from immunologists. When I get a patient from the obstetrician, they want us to do miracles. Most of the time, we don't understand what's happening. You may think that the talk which I'm going to give now is an anguish of an immunologist. There is little consensus on the evaluation and management. Only a handful of what we do are evidence-based. Imagine what are the situations I am going through. When I get a patient referral with one ANA, R1, ABLA positivity, but I am looking at the patient because recurrent pregnancy loss is very common and it increases with the age, and the more pregnancy loss a woman has, more likely that she will have more. So this is a situation, I see a patient and I don't get many information from what the gynecologists have done in the past. I'm not going to teach this. I'm going through what is happening in my mind, and the most common risk factor which can be identified is genetic factors, which is if you do chromosome analysis of the product of conception. But many times I don't have that information in front of me. Whether they have done it, have ruled out, we don't know. And of course, parental chromosomal arrangements can contribute to a small percentage. Anatomical causes. Thrombophilic factors. The literature is always controversial on this issue. The only definitely known contribution to recurrent pregnancy loss and immunological itself is antiphospholipid antibodies. Up to 15-20% of the patients who have RPL may have antiphospholipid antibody syndrome. And when we suspect, when there is more than 3 first trimester abortions, at least one or more death of morphologically normal fetus after 10th week, they are more specific for ABLA rather than the first trimester pregnancy loss, and of course eclampsias, preterm birth, etc. And other immunological factors, they are always suspected but never proven. The role of uterine NK cells, GCSF, peripheral blood NK cells, they were all suspected at some point of time. They were very popular. 10 years back, everybody were going and blasting patients with steroids to reduce this. But nowadays they have tempered down, the evidence is low. Most of the recommendations say that routine testing of this like NK cells are not recommended. And ANA testing, again, widely done, but it definitely is a very non-specific marker. It can be taken as indirect evidence that there could be immunological event happening inside, but doesn't give us more information. Endocrine factors routinely looked at. To my interest is thyroid autoantibodies, because thyroid antibodies, even in a euthyroid patient, seem to increase the risk of recurrent abortions. Can we do anything about it is another question. Environmental factors, always suspected, stress, lifestyle factors, obesity, smoking, alcohol, can all contribute to recurrent pregnancy loss, but very difficult to quantify and never really address. Infections, tuberculosis is always suspected when there is endometrial problems, and syphilis serology is routinely done because there could be one potentially treatable disease. Syphilis may be coming back in the near future. We have not, the last 15-20 years, I have not seen a single syphilis patient. But I think another 5-6 years, it's slowly, you know, in United States it is coming back. I'm sure we will follow it very surely, very soon. So what is happening in a immune-related pregnancy loss? Normally it's a well-regulated orchestra, it goes disrupted, and there is an abortive efficiency shift that results in production of symmetrical antibodies. Actually, when there is Th1 dominant immune system, the asymmetrical antibodies are produced, they are weak in binding to the antigens. But when there is shift to Th1, you produce symmetrical antibodies which goes and binds to the antigens and cause problems. And the shift happens between Th2 to Th1 and also increase NK cell activity and increase production of lymphocyte activated killer cells, which can lead to the problem in the interface between the decidua and the fetus. What are the investigations should be not my domain, karyotyping of the product of conception, which is probably not done on a routine basis in our country at least. Parenteral peripheral blood karyotyping, uterine assessment, these are all not my field. But I don't get the information when I see a patient in front of me. Inherited thrombophilia, antiphospholipid antibodies definitely is useful. Infectious causes, syphilis therapy is always done. Thyroid function is always done, and there are not many tests to assess luteal phase defects, which is could be an important cause for recurrent pregnancy loss, and that could be an immunological low progesterone can be immunologically detrimental to the fetus. The question is, in spite of evaluating up to 50% of the patients who have recurrent pregnancy loss, don't have an explanation. And they are assumed to be immunological. That's a problem. That's why we get a referral. But we also don't know really. That's where because it's a young field. Should we routinely screen every patient for ANA for immunofluorescence? Not sure. But if you get an ANA positivity, that gives you an indirect evidence that there could be an autoimmune process going on somewhere. That gives you some clue to how to deal with it. There can be something tried, though not on evidence-based, but an eminence-based. NK cell is not recommended. Thyroid autoantibodies, probably we should do it. And another thing we should look for is celiac disease. One definite association of recurrent pregnancy loss and immunology is celiac disease, which is not common in our country, but not uncommon as well. So if you find a young, thin woman who is unusually anemic, doesn't get better with oral iron, requires IV parenteral iron supplementation, her albumin is low, globulin is little high in the liver function test, start thinking whether this girl could have celiac disease. Even in the absence of gastrointestinal symptoms, it is worth looking for celiac disease, because stopping gluten can make her better and definitely improve the chance of her succeeding in subsequent pregnancies. So the workup, for immunological workup, ANA, only if ANA is positive, we are going to do what is called as ANA profile, or antibodies against extractable nuclear antigens. One common antibody which we are familiar, you are familiar, is anti-SSA or anti-RO-LA antibody, which is associated with neonatal lupus and congenital heart block. Antiphospholipid antibodies are routinely checked. And there is some evidence that non-criteria antibodies, the criteria antibodies are which we are familiar, lupus anticoagulant, anti-cardiolipin antibody, anti-beta 2 GP1 antibodies. But non-criteria antibodies like anti-prothrombin complex antibodies, anti-phosphatidylserine may also have an important role in recurrent pregnancy loss. So still it is not recommended. Probably we should start thinking in patients who look like APLA. They have second trimester abortions or a pre-eclampsia, and your APLR comes consistently negative. Then probably these are the patients you could do non-criteria antibodies. It is done in some of the laboratories like SRL laboratories. Antithyroid antibodies, anti-TPO antithyroglobulins are routinely done. NK cells, cytokines, T regulatory cells, uterine and NK cells, they are all not recommended for routine use unless we are doing it for a research purpose. This slide I will skip. So how do we treat these patients? What is definite is antiphospholipid antibodies. We should not be doing antiphospholipid antibodies to women who have not had a pregnancy loss in the past. So then we will avoid a situation where asymptomatic patients but comes with the antiphospholipid antibody test positive. But sometimes tests are done, we get patients. At least we treat the patient with only aspirin. We don't give, because there is no history of pregnancy loss, no point in giving heparin. So people seem to jump the gun and give heparin to every other woman who has this test positive, even in the absence of a previous pregnancy loss. If somebody has antiphospholipid antibodies positive and a previous history of pregnancy loss, then the treatment is clear, low molecular weight heparin or conventional heparin with low dose aspirin. And if patient already has a previous history of vascular and APLA, that is thrombotic venous thrombosis or a DVT, we need to do the same treatment. Patient will be on acetron or warfarin till the conception. The moment the woman conceives, switch them over to low molecular heparin, but at a therapeutic dose. 1 milligram per kg body weight of enoxaparin twice a day, not once a day, and aspirin. If the patient has got an arterial thrombosis in the past, pregnancy is contraindicated because the recurrence of arterial thrombosis is very high. It is a very high risk of pregnancy. If you have done everything for last two pregnancies, woman is still losing the pregnancies, of course start looking for other causes. If you don't find any other cause, think of as a refractory obstructive apnea syndrome. Start aspirin at least 4 weeks before even conception, and start no molecular heparin as soon as possible. Moment UPT is positive, you can start and quickly do ultrasound to rule out dual pregnancy. Or people consider switching over to other heparins like tinzaparin or fondaparin. Evidence is more on evidence basis. This is what experts do, like so-called experts who are APLA clinics in some of the specialized centers. Vitamin D is routinely supplemented, but use 2000 units daily rather than 60,000 units once a week, once a month kind of dose, because we still don't know the safety of a large dose of vitamin D on the developing fetus. And vitamin D is an immune active hormone, not a simple B complex vitamin. So don't think that we can throw vitamin D to anybody. It is a bioactive hormone, has potential problems. It can skew the immune system either way. But low vitamin D has been associated with more autoimmunity. So optimizing the vitamin D makes sense in all patients with recurrent pregnancy loss. If this fails, we add hydroxychloroquine, more on evidence based. Lot of trials are happening with hydroxychloroquine in RPL now. There are at least 5 to 6 registered trials which are ongoing recruiting. So we will get a definite evidence on this in APLA and also in non-APLA unexplained recurrent pregnancy loss, presumed autoimmune pregnancy loss. And low dose prednisolone is always used, 5 milligram to 10 milligram. And pentoxifilin is added in subsequent pregnancies, then IVIG, anti-TNF. These are all very rarely used. Sometimes we may have to resort to when somebody repeatedly fails the conventional treatment. Other immunomodulatory treatment which has been popular some time back was GM-CSF, which is definitely has got a role in blastocyst development. Low levels were found in recurrent pregnancy loss. IVIG seem to increase the CSF levels, and shows has a role in T-reg cells. T-reg gives you the protective autoimmunity. It has been associated with implantation failure, and quite a few early preliminary single center trials showed good safety signals and also success with such pregnancy outcomes. But the dampener has come recently in the last year that recent trials did not show a significant increase in clinical pregnancy with routine use of recombinant human granulocyte stimulating factor. The first trimester of pregnancy, they are given throughout the, from conception to the first trimester, they are given. There is no increase in successful live birth rate. They have also used this molecule to improve the endometrial receptivity and thickness. They have used it intrauterine route. Quite a few successful case reports are there. There is one case report from Apollo Hospital, Chennai, one of the journals. So, what are the other immunomodulatory treatment available? Hydroxychloroquine. Hydroxychloroquine is a very pleiotropic drug which has got a good immunomodulating drug. It is not immunosuppressive, because immunosuppression can be a problem. If I go by the previous speaker's talk in the early stages, and that's why I think they are using endometrial biopsy as even a therapeutic tool or endometrial scratching. So this can be antithrombotic, can be useful in APLA, anti-inflammatory effects, so anti-lipid effects, so many useful effects. It can be useful for diabetes if a woman is prone for GDM. So we use it in refractory APLA. It has been studied in recurrent pregnancy loss and recurrent implantation failure, and safe drug probably when everything is exhausted, before the evidence is available, sometimes we tend to use it. And IVIG is tried at 400 milligram per kg body weight every 3 to 4 weeks at conception or before conception. And yes, the recent consensus is it is not useful, not routinely recommended. But I read a recent article from 2019. They have selectively reanalyzed the data. They have looked at, is there any specific group of patients who might benefit from IVIG? They have noticed that people who have started IVIG pre-conception, or if you have used IVIG during this conception, after the conception, and conception failed, but the next conception seemed to succeed. So the exposure of IVIG before a conception seemed to result in a better pregnancy outcome. It is more effective in secondary recurrent pregnancy loss. That means some woman who has had a successful pregnancy or successful pregnancy till term. High dose, that is the dose which I have seen obstetricians using, is very small kind of a mouse doses. The high dose which is used in autoimmune diseases, like 400 milligram per kg body weight per day, that will be 20-25 grams of protein, which would cost you close to maybe 70,000-70,000 rupees per dose, has been found to be useful. And useful in patients who have some autoantibody positive. That means who have some autoimmune background, is more useful. Steroid is always a darling and a villain for immunologists. There are few studies to say that steroid has been useful. Steroid produces the NK cells, improves the pregnancy outcome. But there are few review articles which say that steroid could be harmful and should not be used routinely. There is somewhere, the truth is somewhere in between. But the reassuring data from a recent study is there is a slight increased risk of cleft lip. Not much of a big difference between pregnancy-induced hypertension, eclampsia, GDM, when people were using a small dose of steroids. Slight increased risk of urinary tract infections in these women. So we have to deal with this when we are using steroids. There may be a role for personalized immunotherapy. There is a study which is quite exciting. They have studied the intracellular cytokine ratios of patients who have got recurrent pregnancy loss. Those who had normal cytokines, they have excluded because they may not benefit from immune therapy. They have high cytokines. They have used a combination of intralipids, steroids, 10-15-20 milligrams, and they tapered it over the after conception. Vitamin D, 1,000 units are used in this study. Fish oil, they have used 3 grams of fish oil. That means your regular fish oil capsule, 6 to 9 capsules a day. And a B complex. This combo seems to have increased the pregnancy outcome and success rates. So there may be a role in future. There is no role for a protein screening and giving it to everybody. But when we develop technology and we can do all these cytokine assays and select the patients for this combination immunotherapy or IVIG, probably the outcome might be better. The current scenario, definitely useful is APLA testing and aspirin and heparin. Probably useful are inherited thrombophilia testing like factor 5 ligand, protein C, protein S testing, where low dose aspirin and low molecular heparin might be useful. Anti-TPO testing and thyroid testing is useful. Use the TSH, thyroxine to keep the TSH between 0.5 to 2.5. Progesterone luteal phase support. This is your recommendation, I am done with it. Experimental but safe are hydroxychloroquine and low dose prednisolone. Still experimental. So conclude, apart from obstructive EPLA syndrome, all other immune evaluation and treatments are empirical. The patients are anxious and vulnerable. And gynecologists are vulnerable, we are all vulnerable, so we may end up using unproven therapy to these patients. So we have to offer immunomodulation to this patient only on trial basis and with the informed consent. That is what I have been telling them at Divyashree and their team when I go for the RIF clinic. It is high time we document. We all do things which are not recommended. I use hydroxychloroquine, which is not recommended in any of the recommendations. We have to. Yeah, it looks like I have had few success patients, but I don't know how many patients I have used, how many patients have come back and told that I have become pregnant. happens. So we lose the track. We get to believe that when successful patient come back to us, we tend to believe that what we are doing is right. Sometimes we may have to try to document. I would strongly recommend all the IVF centers to document what they are doing and generate data and publish it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your in-depth presentation.